Hello everyone, this is International Grandmaster Nadya Kosintseva, and today I would like to introduce to you 5 opening traps that demonstrate how quickly a chess game can be lost if a player makes just one bad move at the beginning of the game. Honestly, I'm not a big fan of opening traps if they break some fundamentals of chess. Such traps usually do not work in the long run and may pay off only if your opponent falls into a trap and does not recognize a tactical motif. However, some of opening traps can be pretty solid in their nature, as we will see today, and so can be a good alternative to more common systems. Okay, let's get started and explore some examples. Imagine you're playing white, your favorite move is e4, your opponent played e5, and next you played knight f3, knight c6, and bishop c4. Bishop c4 is not so popular relatively to bishop b5. However, I have to say that a lot of opening traps start with this move. Indeed, the bishop on c4 is actively placed, the bishop is aiming at f7, and pretty often, thanks to this bishop, white can start a very concrete play against the black king already at the beginning of the game. Okay, after white played bishop c4, one possibility for black is knight f6. Black develops the knight with a tempo, taking the pawn on e4, and let's say white plays knight g5. Very concrete move. Both the white bishop and the white knight now attack the pawn on f7. Black should decide what to do with it. And the most natural reaction here is d5. Black wants to block the diagonal for the white bishop. White should play e takes on d5. And if at this point you automatically recapture, if you play knight takes on d5, you will fall into a trap immediately. In fact, the best bet here is not knight takes on d5, but knight a5. Black attacks the bishop and hopes to take the pawn on d5 later once the white bishop leaves the a2 g8 diagonal. White usually plays bishop b5, and after c6, d takes on c6, b takes on c6, white is a pawn up. However, his pieces are not well coordinated, black is more active in general, and so has good chances to prove his compensation in this position. Okay, let's go back to the position after white played e takes on d5, and let's see what happens if black recaptures knight takes on d5. After this move, as we can see, the knight on g5 is hanging. And if white plays, for instance, queen f3, attacking simultaneously the pawn on f7 and the knight on d5, black can just capture this knight, queen takes on g5, and after bishop takes on d5, again, two black pieces are under an attack. However, after black plays queen g6, he can easily protect both of them. White at this point can worsen black's formation by trading his bishop for the knight by playing bishop takes on c6, but in return black gets the bishop pair, and after either queen takes on c6 or b takes on c6, black should be fine. So queen f3 does not bring white a lot, as we could see. But there is another move, and this move is knight takes on f7. So the white knight attacks simultaneously the black queen and the black rook, so black has no choice but to take. King takes on f7, and next white plays queen f3. It's a check, the black king should go to the center. It should go to e6, otherwise white just captures the knight on d5, and next white plays knight c3. White increases his pressure on the knight on d5, black has two ways to protect this knight. If he plays knight e7, this move is passive, and white can immediately play d4. Usually it's good to open up more files when attacking. And the idea behind this move, if e takes on d4, white plays knight takes on d5, knight takes on d5, and next queen e4 check. White immediately occupies the e-file with his queen. Let's say black plays king f6, actually king f6 is a tricky move. Black is setting up his own trap. if white decides that he can win a queen and plays queen h4, for instance, in this position, he can find himself tricked. After black plays king g6, indeed white can take the queen, but only temporary. After queen takes on d8, black has a discovered attack at the disposal. Bishop b4 check. And after c3, rook takes on d8. White can play c takes on b4. White restores the material balance, but black is just better in the endgame because of his more active pieces and because of his healthier pawn formation. So queen h4 does not work, but if instead white plays queen takes on d4, it's good enough. White captures the pawn with a tempo, with a check. Again, the black king should go to e6 to protect the knight. White also move his queen back to e4, and after king f6, white can just capture the knight on d5, either with his queen or with his bishop, or alternatively, white can keep checking the black king. White can play queen f3, white can even play short castle in this position, ignoring the knight. White totally dominates because of the unsecured position of the black king. Okay, knight e7 will be met by immediate d4, as we could see. Instead of knight e7, it's better for black to play knight b4, it's more active move. The knight not only protects the knight on d5, but also counterattacks the pawn on c2. For this reason, white cannot play d4 right now. The most popular continuation here is queen e4, but as for me, if white just castles, his initiative should be strong enough in this position. The pawn on c2 is untouchable because of the black knight on d5. Actually, white is threatening to play a3, and then knight takes on d5 or bishop takes on d5, so black should play c6 at this point. And now white is ready to play d4. Again, it's good for white to open up the position, to bring more forces into the attack. White is ready to sacrifice more. If at this point black captures the pawn on c2, white sacrifices the rook, white plays d takes on e5, and after knight takes on a1, rook d1, in spite of his huge material advantage, black is absolutely helpless. White totally dominates in the center. White is going to play knight takes on d5, then bishop takes on d5, or rook takes on d5. Black cannot oppose a variety of white threats in this position. If not knight takes on c2, let's do queen f6. Black attempts to trade off the queens to simplify the position, but of course white wants to keep the queens on the board. White can temporarily retreat, queen d1. And again, if e takes on d4, white puts his knight to the center with a tempo, knight e4, and after queen f5, white plays c3. Again, white wants to open up the files in the center, and black should realize that the knight on e4 is untouchable after, let's say, d takes on c3, b takes on c3. If black captures the knight, white immediately wins the queen and the game by means of rook e1. Okay, we are done with this trap, and let's switch to the next one. To continue, please take a look at the following diagram. As you can see, I just flipped the board, so we consider the same position just from the black's point of view. So white just attacked the pawn on f7. As we already know, one option for black here is to play d5, and after e takes on d5, he should play knight a5, not knight takes on d5, due to knight takes on f7, followed by queen f3, and white develops a very strong initiative against the black king. However, alternatively, black can play bishop c5 at this point. At first glance, seems to be absolutely crazy. Black leaves the pawn on f7 unprotected, so white can capture it either with his bishop or with his knight. However, things are not so easy as they may seem, and to get an advantage, white should be very precise at this point. The best bet here for white is bishop takes on f7. It's a check. Black usually plays king e7. Black is threatening to play h6 to attack the knight that protects the bishop on f7, so white should move the bishop out. The main line is bishop d5, and next black plays d6. The idea behind this move is to play bishop g4 to bother the white queen. Additionally, black plans to bring the rook to the f-file to transfer his queen to the king's side by playing queen e8 followed by queen g6. As I said earlier, white should be precise to neutralize black's initiative in this position. Actually, it can be not so easy to do. For instance, back to 1983, a former world chess champion, Anatoly Karpov, playing this position white, could not find a good way to get an advantage in this position. Specifically, at this point he played c3, probably with the intention to move the queen out in the case of black's bishop g4. His opponent played queen e8. It looks dangerous. The queen is heading to g6, as we already know. And to minimize the risk, at this point Karpov decided to simplify. He played d4, and after e takes on d4, c takes on d4. His opponent just captured the pawn, knight c3, queen h5, and easily equalized the game. Anyway, bishop takes on f7 is the best bet. After black played bishop c5, maybe at this point, instead of bishop d5, it makes more sense to put the bishop to c4. In order to be able to play bishop e2 if black plays bishop g4 in the future. Still, white should be precise. Still, black can get some compensation if he transfers his pieces on the king side. But objectively speaking, I think black's compensation is not enough. Okay, we are done with bishop takes on f7. And now let's see what happens if white plays knight takes on f7. As for me, it is the most principal continuation. The knight attacks simultaneously the black queen and the black rook on h8. And the key idea behind this opening is bishop takes on f2. Black sacrifices the bishop to bring his queen into the play. White has a choice. White can ignore the bishop, white can capture it. In the case of king takes on f2, black can play knight takes on f4 with a check, and then queen h4 is coming. For instance, if white plays king e1, queen h4, g3, and now knight takes on g3 decides the game in black's favor. The rook on h1 is hanging. This rook is unprotected in the case of h takes on g3, so black gets a decisive material advantage pretty soon. In the case of king f1, again queen h4 works. Black is threatening to play queen f2 checkmate. Knight g3 can be another possibility for black here. In the case of king e2, queen h4 works again. If white captures the rook, his king will be checkmated by force. Queen f2, king d3, knight c5, king c3, and now queen d4 checkmate. If instead of knight takes the rook, white takes control over the f2 square and plays queen e1, black has another tactical resource at the disposal, knight g3, and after queen takes on g3, queen captures the bishop with a check. King e1, queen takes the knight, and black is clearly better here, restoring his material balance. Okay, let's check king g1 as well. Again, black plays queen h4, the queen is heading to f2. If white plays g3, knight takes on g3, after h takes on g3, obviously black cannot capture the rook on h1, but queen takes on g3 is a good alternative to it, so queen takes on g3, king f1, rook f8. Black pins the white knight, black is going to activate his bishop by playing d5 and then bishop g4. Let's say white plays queen h5, actually this move creates no threat, so black can just follow his plan. Black plays d5, and after bishop takes on d5, knight b4 works perfectly for black. The knight attacks the bishop and the pawn on c2 simultaneously, and even if white plays bishop b3, black can just capture the pawn on c2. Bishop takes on c2, and either rook takes on f7 immediately, or bishop g4 decides the game. Okay, so also let's see what happens if instead of h takes on g3, white captures the rook immediately. Now, black should play knight d4. Black accumulates the pressure against the white king. Black is going to play d5 and then bishop g4 and knight f3 to attack the white king. and h3. At this point leads to a perpetual check after queen takes on g3, king f1, queen f4, king e1, queen g3 back. And if the king goes to the g5, black plays queen g5. It's a draw. Okay, the last move to consider is king e3 in this line. Again, black plays queen h4. Again, queen f2 is a deadly threat. White should play g3, knight takes on g3, h takes on g3. At this point, black should precise. Queen takes on g3 does not work due to queen f3. White just blocks the check. But queen d4 seems to be good enough. Queen d4, and after king f3, d5. Notice, black plays very aggressively. Black does not count pieces, black does not count pawns. He wants to bring more and more forces into his attack. The idea to play d5 is to prepare bishop g4. So let's say white also plays active chess, rook h4 counterattacking the black queen, e4 check, king g2, and short castle. Two white's minor pieces are hanging, white cannot keep both of them, so once black takes either the white knight or the white light squared bishop, he should be fine because of his active pieces, because of his safer king. Okay, so now let's see what happens if white ignores the bishop and instead of king takes on f2, plays king f1. The black queen is hanging, there are no more checks, so black should play queen e7. After queen e7, white should play knight takes the rook and d5. Again, the idea is the same, the main idea is the same, to activate the light squared bishop, to finish the development, to connect the pieces as soon as possible. Black prepares bishop g4 specifically. So if white captures the pawn with his bishop, black is winning immediately by means of bishop g4, and the white queen does not have a square to go. If king takes the dark squared bishop on f2, black plays d takes on c4, then again bishop g4, long castle. Black has more than enough compensation for the sacrificed material in this position. The main line is e takes on d5, and next knight d4. So black brings the knight closer to the center, black prepares bishop g4, taking control over the e2 square. Again, if white captures the bishop, knight g4 works well for black. If king g1, there is a simple but powerful queen c5 move, and black is helpless. Whereas if the white king goes to e1, black starts with queen f6, threatening to play queen f2, rook f1, queen h4 check, g3, queen takes on h2, now black is threatening to play queen takes on g3, the only way to oppose this threat is to give up the queen somehow, so black should be fine. If instead of king takes on f2, white plays, let's say, h3 to take control over the g4 square to prevent bishop g4 forever, it weakens the g3 square, so black can play bishop h4, then knight f5, black develops, black castles long, and again, the white king is totally unsafe in this position, white faces an unpleasant defense. Okay, so let's finish the line. After black played knight d4, the best bet for white is to play d6 to unblock the diagonal for his light squared bishop to make knight f7 possible. Black should play c takes on d6. Next, king takes on f2. And now, instead of knight g4, black should play bishop g4. Knight g4 does not work because white can play king g1 and queen c5 is not possible anymore. So black plays bishop g4, queen f1. And long castle. What is interesting, evaluating this position, HS engine believes that white is completely winning due to his huge material advantage. But from a human point of view, from a grandmaster point of view, this position is extremely dangerous for white. Look at his queen side, it's totally undeveloped. Look at his pieces. All his pieces are very poorly placed. A lot of his pieces are at the corner of the board. A lot of his pieces do not contribute to the game at all. So, in a real game, I would say it's nearly impossible to survive playing this position white. For instance, in one game, let's see what happened. White played king g1, black played d5. White played bishop d3, and next rook f8. Black creates a threat of knight e4. Then knight f2, queen c5. White played queen e1. White was forced to move the queen again. Too many queens moves in this game. And next bishop h3. The bishop is untouchable. In the case of g takes on h3, the knight is forking. Knight f3. Black wins the queen. White played knight c3. And after queen c5, he was forced to play g takes on h3. Knight f3. King f1. Knight takes on e1. King takes on f1, e4, and white was totally crashed in this game. Okay, it was an impressive example of counter trap. So, we are done with this position, and let's switch to the next example. Another trap can be set up after the following. e4, e5, knight f3, knight c6, bishop c4, and at this point, instead of knight f6 that we discussed earlier, black can proceed with bishop c5. White castles, black develops a knight with a tempo, attacking the pawn on e4, and one possibility here for white is to play d4 immediately. The main idea behind this move is to open up the center in order to delay black's castling. Intuitively, it should not work well. Usually white needs to spend time to prepare this move to prepare d4. Pretty often white first plays d3, c3, and only after these moves he is able to play d4. However, immediate d4 is tricky move, and black should be precise to oppose white's ideas. So, after white played d4, black has a choice. He should take the pawn on d4, but he can do it either with his knight, with his bishop, or with his own pawn. In the case of e takes on d4, white plays e5, and after this move, black should either play d5, counterattacking the white bishop, or the knight should go. For instance, if black plays knight g4, after white plays bishop takes on f7, king takes on f7, knight g5, followed by queen takes on g4, the black king can be exposed to attacks. If instead of e takes on d4, black captures with the knight, white takes the central pawn on e5, simultaneously attacking the pawn on f7. And if black castles at this point, white has a simple but powerful move at the disposal, and this move is bishop e3. The bishop attacks the knight should go to e6 to watch the bishop on c5. White plays bishop takes on e6, and at this point, black should take the dark squared bishop, otherwise white just plays bishop takes on c5, so bishop takes on e3. But after bishop takes on f7 check, rook takes on f7, knight takes on f7, king takes on f7, white plays f takes on e3, white is an exchange up, white is winning. So, knight takes on d4 does not work as well as e takes on d4, and the best bet here for black is bishop takes on d4. Next, white plays knight takes on d4. Again, black should be precise. In the case of e takes on d4, e5 works well again. The idea behind this move, if knight takes on e5, white plays rook e1, attacking the knight. The knight is pinned. It cannot legally move. Black should play d6, and after f4, white just wins a piece. So, black plays knight takes on d4, and next, white plays bishop g5. White sacrificed a pawn, in return he got a bishop pair, and so white hopes. After he opens up the position, after he plays f4, he will be able to press on the f-file, on the f6 and f7 points. Let's say black plays h6. To keep pinning the black knight, white should play bishop h4, and at this point, one of the most principal continuation is g5. Black hopes that after the bishop retreats, after white plays bishop g3, he first protects the pawn, he first plays d6, and then black can finish the development on the queen side, black can play bishop e6, queen e7, long castle. Thanks to the black pawn on g5, it's not easy for white to activate his dark squared bishop, it's not easy for white to play f4. Black seems to be solid. But the point is that After black played g5, white is not obligated to retreat. Using his lead in development, using his bishop pair, white can sacrifice more. The key move here is f4. White sacrifices a bishop in order to attack the black king. Actually, it's not a sacrifice. If black captures the bishop, white plays f takes on e5, and black should realize both his knights are hanging, both his knights are under an attack. He cannot save both of them, so once white captures either on f6 or on d4, he will be definitely better in the middle game due to the unsafe position of the black king. If instead of g takes on h4, white plays g takes on f4, white can play rook takes on f4, and if e takes on f4, queen captures the knight on d4, followed by bishop takes on f6. White dominates on the dark squares, white dominates in general. If instead of g takes on f4, white plays e takes on f4, again white plays queen takes on d4, g takes on h4, rook takes on f4. The knight cannot leave because of the rook on h8, so white plays rook takes on f6 next. And again, white is attacking. The black king is unguarded, white should be better. If black captures the pawn on e4, again, white plays f takes on e5, the knight on d4 is hanging, let's say black plays knight e6. Next, white plays queen f3, taking the pawn on f7 and simultaneously the knight on e4. And after queen e7, queen takes on e4, g takes on h4, white just develops his knight, knight c3, the knight is heading to d5, then to f6, again, white dominates. Black has a lot of weaknesses in his position. Okay. At this point, the best bet for black is to play actively, is to counterattack, and the best move here is d5. The main idea behind this move is to block the diagonal for the white light squared bishop, and also black wants to bring his own bishop to g4 to attack the white queen. White should play e takes on d5. Now the best bet for black is bishop g4. If instead he plays g takes on h4, again white plays f takes on e5, and both blacks knights are under an attack. G takes on f4 again will be met by rook takes on f4. White should be winning. Whereas if black plays knight takes on d5, white captures the pawn on e5, and knight e3 will be met by queen h5. White is counterattacking the pawn on f7, and that is why black cannot capture either the white rook or the white bishop. White should be winning again. So the best bet bishop g4, and now white plays queen e1. White is aiming at e5. The most principal continuation here is knight takes on c2. If instead black protects the pawn, if black plays knight d7, white can capture the pawn on g5 to open up the f-file. If knight takes on c2, it fails to queen f2. It's fork. White attacks simultaneously the knight and the pawn on f7. Whereas if black plays h takes on g5, white plays bishop f2, it creates a threat of bishop takes on d4, and knight c2 will be met by queen e4, knight takes the rook, and queen takes the bishop on g4. White is an exchange down, but the black king is not secured, the black knight is out of the play, white is going to play knight a3 to trap this knight, so black should play knight c2, but after queen f5, white still wins this knight. Let's say black plays knight b4 and it will be met by bishop c5. The bishop is untouchable due to queen takes on f7 checkmate. White is winning. So knight takes on c2, queen takes on e5 check, queen e7. Queen takes on e7, king takes on e7, f takes on g5. Black was able to trade off the queens to simplify the position, but still, he faces very unpleasant defense, even in the endgame. His pieces are not well coordinated, white's bishops are very powerful. If black captures the rook at this point, white dominates after g takes on f6, king d8, knight a3, and then rook just captures the knight, white should be winning. The knight should go to d7, and now one interesting resource for white is to play d6 to reactivate the light squared bishop. If c takes on d6, white just plays knight c3, the knight is heading to d5, for instance, after knight takes on a1, g6, f6 and knight d5 decides the game, whereas if black captures the pawn with the king, white plays bishop g3, if king goes back to e7, white brings the rook to the 7th rank, rook takes on f7, check, king d8, g6, knight takes the rook, bishop h4, check, king c8, g7. And white is winning after rook g8, white plays rook e7, attacking the rook, the bishop on c4 attacks the rook. White is completely winning in this position in spite of the fact that nominally black has an extra rook. If instead of king e7, black blocks the check by means of knight e5, it will be met by knight c3, knight takes on a1, knight e4, king c6, bishop takes on e5, let's say rook e8 and rook f6, check. After bishop e6, g takes on h6, again nominally black has an extra exchange in this position, but he's completely losing. White has more than enough compensation in this position for the exchange. Finally, if the king runs to c5, to the c-file, white can use it by playing rook c1, and after knight takes the rook, white recaptures the light squared bishop, white plays bishop e2, king d5, bishop takes on g4, the knight on d7 is hanging, white is going to play knight c3 to capture another knight on a1, white is completely winning. Okay, we are done with this example, and to continue, let's flip the board again and explore another trap from the black's point of view. As you could see, our previous traps were pretty solid in nature, not breaking some fundamentals of chess. This one is different. This one is a poor gamble and can pay off only against inexperienced players. Let's see. e4, e5, knight f3, knight c6, bishop c4, and at this point, instead of regular development moves, knight f6 or bishop c5, black can play a weird move of knight d4. As for me, it is just bad, because usually it's not a good idea to move the same piece twice or more in the opening, with no good reason. The most important thing in the opening is development. What's more, playing this move, black leaves the pawn on e5 unprotected. So the first idea that could come to your mind in this position is to take this pawn. But if you are playing white, don't do it. The pawn is poisoned, and if white plays knight takes on e5, black's gamble pays off immediately after he plays queen g5. The queen attacks simultaneously the knight on e5 and the pawn on g2. If at this point white plays knight takes on f7, black captures the pawn on g2 and he is winning immediately. If, for instance, knight takes the rook on h8, black captures the rook on h1 with a check, bishop f1, then queen captures the pawn on e4 with a check. Again, and after white plays bishop e2, the simplest option for black is to take the pawn on c2 with a check, after which white should give up the queen. If instead of queen takes on c2 he runs, if he plays king f1, black finishes the game in one move, queen h1, and that's it for white, it's checkmate. Okay, after queen takes on g2, let's see also what happens if white plays rook f1. Black captures the pawn on e4 with a check, and after white plays bishop e2, there is no need even to take the pawn on c2. Knight f3 finishes the game in one move again. Checkmate in one. Okay, after black played queen g5, another possibility for white is to play knight g4. Now black cannot capture the pawn on g2. It would be good if not d5. Playing this move, black not only attacks the white light squared bishop, but also opens the diagonal for his own light squared bishop, and so the knight on g4 is hanging as well. There is no way for white to save both his minor pieces, so black is winning immediately after d5. Okay, instead of knight g4 and knight takes on f7, it's better for white to play bishop takes on f7. Black has a choice. At first glance, it looks like black should play king e7 to attack the bishop. Now, if white knight leaves, black just captures the bishop. But the problem with this move is that after white plays short castle, queen takes on e5, Bishop takes on g8, rook takes on g8, white plays c3, and white gets a chance to advance his central pawns with tempi, using the unpleasant position of the black king. Specifically, if black plays, for instance, knight e6, white can play f4. This move works, because in the case of knight takes on e4, there is d4 move, and white immediately restores the material balance. Or, if queen takes on e4, white pushes the pawn to f5 to attack the knight, and black should realize the knight cannot leave. If knight goes to g5, for instance, white immediately wins the queen, rook e1. So, let's try king d8. King d8. If white implements the same idea, short castle, queen takes on e5, c3, knight e6, let's say bishop takes on g8, rook takes on g8, now d4 fails. Black can just capture the central pawn, and there is no real way for white to continue his attack. Rook e1, queen f5, and after d5, the knight can go to c5, or black can play bishop c5, counterattacking the pawn on f2. Black should be winning. Another thing that black should predict when he plays king d8 is what happens after knight g4. Now, if black plays d5, this move attacks only the knight on g4, the bishop on f7 is not hanging anymore, so white can play knight e3 to take care of the pawn on g2, and then white castles, and white will be better in the middle game due to the unsafe position of the black king. But instead of d5, black has another powerful move at the disposal, and this move is knight h6. The knight is forking two white minor pieces, and the KD is the same. In the case of knight takes on h6, black is not going to recapture the knight. Instead, he captures the pawn on g2, he attacks the pawn on e4, and white is helpless immediately. Okay, interesting idea, nice trick, but strategically risky, and if white knows how to deal with it, black can run into troubles very quickly. For instance, after white plays knight takes on d4, e takes on d4, and short castle in this position. Okay, to finish the topic, I would like you to watch a trap that was set up by Mikhail Chigorin, one of the best players of the 19th century. So, let's watch. Okay, this game started with e4, e5, knight f3, knight c6, bishop c4, bishop c5, short castle, knight f6, and at this point white played d3. Black responded symmetrically, d6, and next white proceeded with bishop g5. It's tempting to develop the bishop this way. The bishop is pinning the black knight pretty often. It can be a good base to build a pressure on the king's side. The only question that arises here, what happens if black pushes his pawns on the king's side in order to drive the bishop away? In the game, black played h6 for this purpose. White proceeded with bishop h4 and next g5, the most principal continuation. The bishop should go to g3. Actually, playing g5, black weakened a number of squares on the king's side. It can be controversial. If he castles short, his king can be exposed to attack. On the other hand, it makes sense to advance the pawns on the king's side if black castles long, if black considers pawn advance on the king's side to attack the white king. And at this point, believe it or not, Chigorin, playing black, started his attack immediately. He played h5 immediately without any preparation. Looks unprepared at first glance, because white can play knight takes on g5, attacking additionally the pawn on f7, but knight takes on g5 is a mistake, and after Chigorin played h4, he develops a very strong initiative against the white king. So next, white should play knight takes on f7. In the case of bishop takes on f7, black just retreats, king e7. There is no way for white to save the bishop. Black should be winning. So in the game, white played knight takes on f7. one possibility here for black is queen e7, but Chigorin was not going to retreat. He keeps attacking, he keeps sacrificing, and his move was h takes on g3. White should take the queen, and next black played bishop g4. Now the white queen is hanging, white should move his queen. In the case of knight takes on c6, black gets a material advantage by means of bishop takes on f2. White should play rook takes on f2. In the case of king h1, there is checkmate in one, rook takes on h2. So rook takes on f2, g takes on f2, king takes on f2. Black plays bishop takes on d1, black is an exchange sharp, black should be better in this endgame. So, in the game, white played queen d2, and next, Chigorin played knight d4. Playing this move, he creates a threat of knight e2, and if white plays king h1, rook takes on h2, checkmate in one again. In the game, white played knight c3, this move seems to be logical, white develops, white takes control over the e2 square, but this move is a decisive mistake. Instead, if white plays h3, black is able to play knight e2. Now the best bet for white is to give up the queen to play queen takes on e2. In the case of king h1, black finishes the game by means of rook takes on h3, g takes on h3, and bishop f3. Final shot. So queen takes on e2 is forced, bishop takes on e2. Now the rook on f1 is hanging, this rook cannot leave. Because of bishop takes on f2, followed by rook takes on h3, and then bishop f3, another checkmate pattern. If instead white plays knight e6, notice knight e6 is better than knight b7, because after black moves his bishop to b6, the knight can be trapped. So knight e6, still, the best continuation here for black is bishop b6, to watch the pawn on c7. The rook on f1 is still hanging, still, it cannot leave, it cannot move because of bishop takes on f2, followed by rook takes on h3 and bishop f3. White should play knight c3, and after bishop takes on f1, king takes on f1, g takes on f2. Black is an exchange sharp, currently white has a pawn for it. He hopes to take another pawn eventually. The ending seems to be pretty even. Maybe slightly better for white if he is able to keep his pawn on f2, if he is able to create threats against the white king. Okay, h3 was the best bet for white. In the game he played knight c3 and he was punished immediately. Chigorin played knight f3 check, g takes on f3, bishop takes on f3, and white is helpless. Black is threatening to play g takes on h2 checkmate. White cannot legally capture the pawn on g3 with his own f-pawn because of the pin, because of the bishop on c5, whereas h takes on g3 will be met by rook h1, checkmate in one. Okay, nice game, nice tactical idea. We are done for today. I hope you found something interesting for yourself. Thank you for watching and good luck in your games.